shwemuva kotwa munja nubo.
Baby, nyaba kona bonke Ake kufana nawe usispiwo kumu Kubo bonke Chikete wena Chikete wena Kubo bonke Chikete wena Kete wena ebo nyame Timameli njizio yami ino mbuzo ochi Unga mdono abisa umbo mimamu bonke nifuna na no mundo uwe Bendi pelele nitemba kwa kanya gawe Kubo bonke chikete wena Tando Kubo bonke stando sami Chikete wena Chikete wena Kubo bonke Chikete wena Chikete wena Kubo bonke Chikete
thank you.
no huyo mandi bonu busoba tibule lomdali kondipa wena dize ngobuhle nangozi thoba ditembe ntiyacela anisose ligmoshi obuhle bakho Upinde kwa wena undithande Tisvedi siti ulubambo lwami Tohlala ndifuna wena ubuhle bakho
for Ike on the guitar. The next song is called the Intra-African, and shout out to Sanal Musician who produced it.
I'm
So much. The last song, we don't have much time, Abalele, and this is my goodbye to you. Mabavuke betuna nabalele.
Sometimes I'm not. Maka, African women still struggle to find insightful, informative, and diverse content that addresses their experiences, needs, and interests. Through the power of education, entrepreneurship, and collective action, we have developed a purpose-driven platform that cultivates the importance of development for Africa's youth. We strive to build long-term partnerships with organizations that share similar values, looking to invest in empowering historically marginalized communities and embarking on projects that drive real action and change through innovative content and experiences that directly benefit the community we have cultivated. By working with Amaka, you are centering African stories and sharing our values in championing us, challenging misconceptions, and securing an impactful legacy. Together, we showcase the dynamism of Pan-African womanhood. This is Amaka.
culture for dreadlocks, egg-shaped escapes. We all lose hope in our elements. Elements play dues, same clef, same hue. Hippie bass, chasing a space just to praise war. Wings spark tension, respect, pavements adjacent. Cause fucking streets is baseless and a touch too complacent. We walk, talk, and change minds with crooked eyes. I listen, begging the high just to bless my high or my sky. We met in township and courtship, as you and I pregnant. Never with thought, always got caught by throws that fly. We be laced, we be blazed clean, in these black, yellow, and days green. In these black, yellow, and days green. In these black, yellow, and days green. Excuse me, as I kiss you high. Pregnant, you ask why townships never kiss the sky. I said our courtship, a township, your mongrel, my element. Lost to the irrelevant testament of us being in love. So we switched and we ditched lover's glove. Trust never enough to keep us from house in forever. Now in the diamonds pairing, I say.
Ladies and gents, after all of that excitement, we are now ready for our next session. The Nigerian International Film Summit is an event and platform that seeks to discuss the opportunities, possibilities, concerns, and challenges revolving around the business of film in Nigeria for international distributors and film investors, and how fast the local Nollywood film industry is evolving to meet with international production standards and expectations. Today, the Nigerian International Film Summit here at Canex 2021 has convened a panel of film industry experts to focus on the opportunities for cross-border or pan-African film cooperation in order to unlock the untapped opportunities for job creation and revenue generation in Africa. Please join me in warmly welcoming our moderator for the panel today. It's Ijeoma Ona, who is the founder of the Nigeria International Film Summit. Please give her a warm round of applause.
Good evening, everyone. It's such a pleasure to be here. Like I've been introduced, my name is Ijeoma Ona. I'm the founder of the Nigerian International Film Summit. So what we do with the Film Summit is to build bridges between Nigeria and different countries, not just within Africa, but also outside of Africa. We are all about the business of film, helping bringing top executives together on a business-to-business basis to look at the things that need to be known for the expansion of business of film between Nigeria and, like we said, other countries who are looking for opportunities, and vice versa. So it's such a pleasure to be here this evening, and we're going to be looking at the opportunities for cross-border productions, okay, pan-African productions. What are the limitations? What are the challenges? Why are we not seeing things happening between Nigeria, South Africa, Kenya, and so on? And it's such a pleasure to have on the lineup of our panelists this evening, top executives and within the film and TV industry in Africa. I want to start by introducing Jackie Mosepe, who is the COO of the KZN Film Commission. Please, can you just help me welcome her to this session, Jackie? Welcome, Jackie. And then we also have, from Nigeria, we have Moses Babatope, who is the Managing Director of Film One Distribution and Productions. Ladies and gentlemen, Moses Babatope is here this evening with us. And finally, we have on this panel Adesanya Oyeneye. She is the Executive Director of Smooth Promotions. They are the organizers of the Headies Awards and also the owners of Hip TV. Ladies and gentlemen, Adesanya. Okay, so I would just quickly ask the panelists to introduce themselves briefly in 1-2 minutes. Tell us more about your business and within the context of what we're trying to do to drive these conversations around Pan-African collaborations. What are the limitations? What are the opportunities that we have? So I'm going to start with you, Adesanya. You're going to tell us more about Smooth Promotions. How long have you been around? What have you been doing? And we'll take it from there. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Hip TV is an urban cultural platform. It's we're into music, lifestyle, and entertainment. Our viewership is in numbers. We're looking at above 50 million in 15.5 million households, and we're in 44 sub-Saharan African countries. Beyond the television, we're also the organizer of the most prestigious music events, which is known as the Headies. This year is going to be the 15th year, and we're into production. I mean, events, production, and the likes. Good evening, everyone, once again.
Thank you. Thank you. That was quite brief. Thank you very much. And I'll go to Moses now for his own introduction.
All right. Good afternoon, everyone. It's great to be here. My name is Moses Babatope. I am the co-founder of the Film House Group. It's a media entertainment company that group that comprises of a cinema exhibition company known as Film House Cinemas, which is the largest cinema exhibition company in West Africa. Boasts of partnerships like the IMAX Corporation, with the IMAX Corporation, MX4D, and D-Box. We are the third largest on the continent, and we continue to grow and expand. We also have Film One Entertainment, which is a content production and distribution company, as Ijoma just introduced. We are partners with some of the top Hollywood studios like Warner Brothers, Disney, and Empire Entertainment out of South Africa, who we do some sub-distribution for in West Africa. We also are partners with Netflix and are aggregators for them in terms of distributing Nigerian and African content. Within the group, we have two other new subsidiaries, including a physical production subsidiary known as Sandbox, which we've not really done a lot of announcements on, and Filmhouse Plus, which is our foray into the VOD, or would I say, OTT space, from a value added perspective. I'll stop here for now. That's what we're about. Thank you.
Fantastic. Thank you very much, Moses, for that. And then I'll go to Jackie. Hi, Jackie.
Hi. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
So my name is Jackie Mutsipe. I am with the KwaZulu-Natal Film Commission, and we're based here in Durban, KwaZulu-Natal. Our offices are literally just down the road. Mm-hmm. We've been established here now for 7 years as a provincial film commission. Our role is to grow the film industry in KwaZulu-Natal as a destination and a location for film. So we've got various programs in that regard, from the funding of films, local films, co-productions, both local and international. We're very active in that space. Obviously, the international promotion of KZN as a destination, and we participate in a number of platforms, really attracting investment into the province. But we're also very strong in terms of building indigenous films. We've got a number of skills training programs to train filmmakers at different levels of expertise, from your short programs to your more long-term programs. We also have a bursary program for students to study film at university. We're very big on audience development within the province, building audiences for South African film. So we have a number of initiatives in the different municipalities which we partner with in KZN. We also have what we call a one-stop shop for film inquiries. So anybody who is looking to film their film anywhere in KZN, we facilitate for that. We work very closely with the Durban Film Office, which is very, very firmly established in eThekwini and facilitates films across the city. We then work across the province in really making sure that you are able to access the different locations around the film. And we do various initiatives in terms of that, promoting the talent that's here, promoting the facilities, and also obviously promoting the locations. So pretty much that's who we are as KZN Film Commission.
Interesting. Thank you very much for that. And I just want to start, permit me to start with you, just touching from what you just said about the KZN and the efforts of KZN. This event, for the few time I've spent here, I've heard a lot around Pan-Africanism, and I've also, it's something I believe strongly in, even in Berlin, in Cannes. I've been privileged to speak about the fact that we go outside of Africa, we talk about ourselves as Africa, but when we come within the continent, you find out that, you know, there's little or nothing happening, you know, between us. So I'm just wondering, from a film commission perspective, your government, and you're doing quite a lot, you know, to develop your local industry. Are you having plans for expansion with the, you know, outside of South Africa, maybe Western Africa, Eastern Africa? What are your efforts? What are you currently doing to make sure that this
National Film Festival in Lagos, Nigeria? Over the years, we've really refined that strategy to say, how can we work more with our partners on the continent? You know, I myself have come from the National Film and Video Foundation, where we did a lot of international exhibitions in different parts of the world, Yokan, Toronto, your major A-list film festivals, really attracting partnerships to come and shoot their films in South Africa. We also used to attend a FESPACO as a platform. But beyond that, you know, there wasn't really any broader engagement. So what we're really focusing on in terms of one of our strategic priorities is really to see how can we build partnerships, how can we build relationships with our African counterparts on the continent. So since we've been attending AFRIF over the years, one of the things is really to understand each other as different industries, because we have different ways of operating. Not everything is the same. And it is important to see what is available on the ground, what are our strengths, what are our weaknesses, how can we complement one another. And one of the big things that we saw from the Nollywood industry is just, you know, the way the films are able to be distributed, you know, the way the content is consumed. In a very, very big way, which is very different to what we have in South Africa. You know, you put your films out into cinema, they enjoy a cinema release, but you can't compare that with what actually happens in Nigeria. We're very strong technically in South Africa in terms of our production values, the films that we put out. So we've been really looking at ways of saying, how can we work together? How can we explore each other's industries? How can we explore each other's stories, culture? And as a result, with Nigeria in particular, you know, there are two projects one has already been done, and the second one is literally about to go into production in the next few weeks. We've been developing the story, developing the scripts with South African and Nigerian writers, and it's fully cast now. The production is literally ready to go. We've also been working quite a lot with Kenya. We've been attending the Kalasha film market in a similar way, working with the industries there. What we did is really to see on the continent, what are the filmmaking destinations that are quite active, and how can we partner with those destinations? So we have been to Kalasha. We have a project that's been fully developed as well with Kenya.
Interesting.
And we're now looking to finance that project so that it can also go into production. So it's a very much a big part of our strategy. We are also going to be going to Rwanda at the end of the year, and I'm sure quite a number of people will be going to DISCOP, really just to explore what's happening in Rwanda and again see what relationships we can strike there.
Wow, interesting to hear that finally this kind of collaborations are happening on a country-to-country level, especially between South Africa and Nigeria, because I think it's about time that, you know, we begin to leverage on our strengths. You know, you have your strengths in terms of technical, and we have our strengths in commercial side. So how do we come together to build on the strengths, to leverage on each other's strengths? I think it's a good time to go to theater, to go to cinemas, and then you are seeing South African and Nigerian cast together. I think it's something that is quite commendable. Thank you for holding forth. It's been 7 years to get to this point. Thank you, and congratulations in advance. I believe it's going to be a fantastic project, and I'm sure everyone here will be looking forward to that. All right, thank you, Jackie. So we'll go now to Moses. Moses, locally in Nigeria, you've distributed most of the biggest blockbusters. Maybe you can actually start from there to tell us some of the successes you've had locally. You also mentioned that you represent major Hollywood studios, Warner Bros., I think Disney as well. So So locally, your success is not questionable. I mean, from one blockbuster to another, you have done those distributions and releases across from a distributor perspective. And of course, having an exhibition company, Film House Cinemas. Any screens now from Film House?
So we have 13 locations in 7 states, about 51 screens.
That's the highest now?
In the country, in the region, yes.
Oh, wow. Interesting.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. So that's interesting to know that one of Nigeria's biggest exhibition companies, Film House Cinemas, right here is the managing director of the distribution subsidiary of the group. It's the Film House Group. And they've been quite successful. Most of the major Nollywood blockbusters, Omogeto, I think it's only coming second to Black Panther in terms of revenue. You know what? I'm just going to leave Moses because he understands how to put out these things. And then, but from there, you're going to text for you within the continent. Are you just going to get comfortable with Nigeria and the successes you've had in Nigeria? Or I know you also have one or two partnerships in South Africa, but beyond that, what else is your strategy for expansion in, you know, Pan-Africa?
Thank you, Ijoma. I think it's important to note with all the successes we've gotten that we are a local company with a global outlook. We're a local company with Africa first, you know, strategy. Like Jackie has said, there's something that has gone on right with the filmmaking in Nigeria in terms of, you know, the commerce of it. The truth is, it's a strong local content, you know, creation territory. But what is also becoming very evident and hard to dismiss is it's a very strong local content consumption territory across multiple platforms. When we delved into cinema, the Film House Cinemas, when we launched the first cinema in December 2012, I think it was, we had seen patterns emerging. I mean, modern cinemas came back to Nigeria in 2004 through our colleagues at Silverbird. And I think the first real films that started succeeding came out in 2008, 2009. But what we saw was an appetite to actually experience Nigerian films out of home. And it kept growing and kept growing. And as technology became, you know, accessible, as more filmmakers came into the fore and improved their storytelling and the way they made films, and we also improved the way we marketed films to people, it became apparent that we had, you know, an income stream that was waiting to be tapped. And like you rightly said, we've seen a lot of success. We're grateful to not just be distributors of some of the highest grossing films, but also co-producers. And working from infancy stage, from ideation stage, to see the things that made those films succeed. Wedding Party 1 and Wedding Party 2 are great case studies that we co-produced. Wedding Party 2, a lot of people do not know that Wedding Party 2, we actually released in 15 African countries theatrically. That's something, it's not business intelligence. You've released in these countries, you've taken a lot of learnings. We released in about 10 cinemas in Southern Africa. Majority of them in South Africa. We released in Kenya, in Tanzania, and in Uganda. We released in the West Africa, we released in Nigeria, Ghana, and Liberia, and then Francophone countries, including some in Central Africa. So we were able to get a lot of insights. But I think we had the kind of film that not just Nigeria was, you know, excited about, the continent was, you know, excited about. But at the time, It was probably earlier, you know, because earlier than its time. Because cinema infrastructure across the continent is not totally where we want it to be. In fact, it's nowhere near. And I think that's for a session or an event like this, I think that those are the kind of things we need to talk about. Even in spite of, you know, the obvious opportunities that digital platforms bring up. So I think in summary, we've done and seen a lot of success with our films in Nigeria. We have an ambition to ensure that we can get, you know, more Nigerian films out to African countries, but also on the other way around. In 2019, we released a film called Baby Mamas from South Africa. We thought that the theme was right and was relatable, And we also got very good insights. As far as we are concerned, we thought the film was a success because it didn't have your typical Nigerian star. It didn't have, you know, it was not, you know, from Nigeria. But we noticed that the Nigerian palette is very eclectic, can take a number of, or value films from different parts of the world. If you just go to Nigeria and look at the top 10, you see films from Turkey or India or, you know, China or Korea, you know, getting to the top 10. So that in itself, as business people, but as people that also want to improve, you know, film commerce on the continent, that we can do, you know, vice versa. We can get Nigerian films out to the continent and we can get the best of African films into Nigeria. Yes, with limitations, therefore the product has to be right. Therefore, we need to be saying to the market what kind of films need to be made so that there's guarantee of reinvestment returns. Those are the learnings, those are the things that we're taking into consideration. COVID has been sort of a reality check and slowed down our momentum a little bit, but it's not slowing down our ambition to like I said, improve more of the commerce of film within the continent.
So what would you consider as your key target territories? Like, you know, what are your priority territories within Africa?
When, if you just look at the location of screens right now, South Africa is the most mature in terms of the number of screens in South Africa. And it represents an opportunity for us because the local content penetration in terms of South African films in cinema is not where it should be. And we think that there is a market here for that. So South Africa particularly is a target market. We think Kenya, Uganda, Tanzania are also target markets. And let me also say that they are target markets for us to look at, not only from getting the films to physical cinema, but also from a cinema company trying to look at the areas of expansion if capital becomes available. We're hoping that our folks and friends at Afrexim, who I believe are behind this event, are listening keenly, that the, this is me beginning to do sales pitching, hoping that we can access capital to unlock, you know, screen opportunities, not because of our own, you know, commercial gain, but because cinema experiences for the generation right now are still very new in Africa, you know, and that is something to tap into. The if the experience is right and the cinemas are well built, people will come. Absolutely. And it's important to note that we cannot also streamline revenue streams to just digital platforms. Mm-hmm. It becomes very, very, very dangerous. So we need to make sure that the cinemas expand, the digital platforms are there. And to just conclude my answer to your question, in West Africa, of course, Ghana and Liberia. In East Africa, I've just mentioned those. And you know, there's some talk with what we can do with North Africa. So we're looking at those, but those are the key territories that we look at.
Thank you. Thank you so much. So if you saw one of the things, key things I just took out from what Moses said is cinema business within Africa is still at its very, you know, early stages. There's still a lot of opportunities untapped. Potentials and opportunities, and that means that even with the streaming businesses, you don't consider them a threat to the growth of cinema business.
Not yet. No.
Not yet. So that's, I mean, it could be debatable, but I think I also share in that because I know that the experience, you know, it's completely different, and a lot of people still look forward, you know, to going to cinemas to have just to have that immersive experience. Thank you very much, Moses, for that. And then I'll just go straight to the Adesanya, who is executive director of Smooth Promotions. They hold one of the, I mean, I think it should be the biggest, correct me if I'm wrong, music awards in Nigeria. They had this award, and they also have Hip TV. I'm just wondering, you've been very, very Nigerian-centric, right? Doing a lot. I mean, the brand is so popular locally, so strong among the, you know, very young demographics. Maybe you can tell us, you know, a bit about your demographics. But beyond Nigeria, what are your plans? Do you see opportunity in South Africa for what you're doing in Nigeria with the awards, with the channel? I know the channel is seen across Africa, but I would like to know if you also have some strategy, like Moses just shared, like Jackie just shared, to move out into Africa beyond Nigeria.
Right, thank you, IJ. So as a business, over the years, if you know generally how business works, you really want to try out some things and not go out, come back with errors. So over the years, we've tried to establish the platform as a company in Nigeria, but it's viewed in 44 sub-Saharan African countries. Now, our strategy is to also move to other African countries. Currently, we're setting up offices and structures in Sierra Leone. We're looking at Ghana, we're looking at Kigali, and a couple of African countries. However, if you understand content as well, you would know that if you're very fan-centric, meaning if you know what your consumers really want, it doesn't apply across board. So what is peak in South Africa might be different for Nigeria. So as a business, the strategy is we're trying as much as possible to communicate in that language that everybody understands in their own sphere and in their own space. I'm going to give you an analysis. So prior COVID, I like to talk in numbers because for me, for every conversation we have, we must be talking about revenue, we must be talking about figures, else we'll just be having a conversation at the end of the day. Everything boils down to Naira and Kobo in the case of Nigeria. So prior COVID, globally, revenue was going from $1.8 trillion to $2 trillion. That is before COVID. Immediately we had COVID, everything dropped by 3.5%, which has been the biggest drop ever in history as far as E&M industry, entertainment and media industry is concerned. Now, a whole lot of people, it was supposed to be a big hit, but it really didn't suffice as such because people embraced the internet. So with the emergence of internet and people consuming product on the digital space, the gap was filled in a couple of months, right? And from that projection, it implies that if we begin to go with that trend of internet in another 5 years, it means that we'll be jumping by 5%, meaning in another 5 years, if you calculate it, we'll be having like, say, $2.6 trillion in terms of revenue dollars. That is huge. That is to tell you that the gold mine is actually entertainment. So it's like a clarion call for every business that is seated here or around this conference that if you have that revenue, whether you're an investor, you're an individual, you're a multinational, and you're not investing into media and entertainment in the next 5 years, you won't be in the space anymore because that's the truth. Wow. Content is king, and we all know that. Now, so as a strategy for us as a business, we're trying to be fan-centric. The people that are dictating the tune now are you and I. It's no longer a function of a producer or a content person trying to sell out what you feel people will appeal to. So it's a function of what do you want? So take, for example, in the marketing industry, what you do there. Some individuals do what they call, some brands do what they call product sampling. The essence of product sampling is not just for you to, it's for me to know how you feel about the product, if it's viable, if I can continue with it. If I do my product sampling over a period of time and it's really not giving me the ROI that I want, we'll go back to the drawing board and then do something else. That's why sometimes when you see some brand, they will say, so take for example, they will produce, let me use Coca-Cola for example now. So 1 minute you're saying Coke, the next minute you're saying Coke Zero, the next minute you're saying Coke without gas, the next minute you're saying Coke with a certain percentage of sugar. It means that you are the one dictating what I do as a brand. So it's very simple. If I really want to be out there, if I really want to be strategic, I must understand what everybody wants. So it's not me going back to my drawing board and doing whatever I want and putting it out there. So as a business, we're trying to work on projects per country. So whether it's African country, whether it's globally, we want to know what is sellable. If it's sellable, is it viable? If it's viable, can it be continuous? If it's continuous, can he bring down figures? Because at the end of the day, for some people, they have the revenue to pump into business. For some, they don't. Some source money from investors. Some go to banks. Some have seed investments and the likes. At the end of the day, as a businessman or as a business entrepreneur, you want to say, this is how much I've made. You want to be able to pay salary. You want to be able to run recurrent expenditure. So it is high time we started sitting down and drawing out a map of whatever thing that you think you have a passion for, whatever product you think you want to put out there, what can bring out the value, which is money, if you understand what I mean. So as a business, that's the strategy. We are being fan-centric. We are giving people what they want, and that's the key.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I just want to remind us that our conversations are always very intense at the Nigerian International Film Summit. We have it every year at the American Film Market and also in France. And what we've been doing is to deliberately drive conversations around business. I know that there's always a lot of focus on the creative side of things. Please don't get it twisted. There's nothing wrong with that. But we need to create that balance. We need to begin to see creative businesses as what they are. They are businesses, right? And if run as businesses, from what you are hearing here from this executive sitting here, in terms of strategy, instead of planning, they will begin to see that these businesses can actually affect the entire economy, the ecosystem. Jobs are going to be created. They're going to be sustainable. It's not just enough to have a passion, because creative people are very passionate. Oh, yes. When they're setting out on that movie project, they believe that this project is going to be very successful. But have you really sat down with the experts? Have you, if you're a producer, have you sat down with Moses to make sure that this project is going to tick tick the boxes that will make it a commercial hit? I was just having a conversation backstage, and Jackie mentioned that for this project between Nigeria and South Africa, that Moses is actually on that project. Why is he on that project? Because they need his perspective, they need his input as a distributor. He's going to advise them that this is the strategy you're going to employ in marketing, even the casting, and so on and so forth. So we're all trying to make sure that on the business side of film, on the business side of television, on the business side of content, that we as Africans are well equipped with the right kind of knowledge that, you know, will help us build sustainable business. And having said that, I would just want to quickly run through our panelists again and ask, what are the limitations? I mean, you shared a fantastic vision that you have, and you're already running with them. Is it that easy? I want to talk about limitations and barriers at the same time. What are the challenges? What are things that are kind of slowing you down? What will you consider as an ease, will I call it ease of doing this business, especially since it's not in your comfort zone? You're getting out of your comfort zone to do these things.
Yes, no, absolutely. Look, I think there will always be challenges, you know, and limitations. I think initially one can say that it's the getting to know each other, mm-hmm. because what we found was that actually, even though we may know how Europe works, how their funding works, how their system works, how they produce content, we found that as Africans, we don't really know and understand each other. So initially it can be a barrier, and obviously if you go and look at other countries on the continent, you know, language obviously does become a barrier with your Francophone and Lusophone and so on. But even amongst English-speaking countries, it is that getting to know each other, building the trust and the confidence also is important, between the two countries. I think another barrier, another challenge is obviously finance. You know, finance in film is always this is always a challenge. And one of the things that we've been trying to do with Nigeria, with Kenya, the countries that we're speaking to, is to say that how can we have a formal co-production treaty with another African country, in the same way that we do in South Africa with about 9 different countries around the world. You know, we've got treaties with the UK, with Ireland, with Canada, you know, the list goes on. But we've got 9 official co-production treaties. But we don't have any official co-production treaty with any African country. We've got three that are draft treaties. So one is a draft with Nigeria, we've got a draft with Algeria, and we also have a draft with Kenya. There have been a lot of discussions, you know, between the countries. But the main challenge is a financial instrument within our partner country at a governmental level, at a national level. So in South Africa, we've got quite a number of funds, national funds, provincial funds. And the main challenge with finalizing those treaties is actually for those countries to set up, a special fund that services the industry. Right, and we know that collectively we are, as countries, as governments, we're actually building, the industries and keeping them sustainable. So I think that is another challenge, because as soon as you have a treaty, you've got an instrument through which you can easier, you know, for you to produce content between the two countries. But it hasn't stopped us, as you've heard. We are still making films. I think another possible challenge, and I think with these collaborations is something that can be overcome, is knowing who our celebrities are. I suppose with Nollywood celebrities are very well known, even in South Africa, across the diaspora. But on the other side, that is not necessarily the case with our South African cast. And these types of initiatives will hopefully, in the long run, make our African talent, South African talent, become household names across the continent.
I see. Yeah. Very interesting. Thank you very much. I understand the place of co-productions in, helping these things happen. But we are coming, especially in Nigeria, we are pretty much business people. We don't wait for governments. Mm-hmm. Most of the things we do, is purely from business to business side. Mm-hmm. So I think it's important to also begin to look at it from that business to business angle, where companies are coming together to leverage on their strengths. Production companies from here can talk to a Moses who has a production structure in place in Nigeria. Putting your strengths together, it could actually bring down the cost. You see what I mean? And like you said, it doesn't stop things. The co-production treaties that have not been signed doesn't actually stop this kind of collaborations from happening. And I use the French as an example. They've been very deliberate in working with Nigeria, in making things happen. Recently, a French-Nigerian, I'll call it a co-production. Yes, it was. But it was purely a business-to-business co-production that happened. It was released, I think, last month or 2 months. And because they were very, they were very strategic about it. They are very deliberate, in making sure, bringing French professionals from France to come and sit down 2 days, meet and network with the industry. I think that was 2019. And after that happened, we begin to see things happening. French companies are working in Nigeria and vice versa. So the point is, we need to be very intentional. We have to be very deliberate in these things. It's not going to happen on its own. So it's not just enough for us to sit down here and listen to these conversations. What is the next step? What do we do after here? I think that's something that we all, I throw it out as a challenge, that we, as much as possible, let's maximize the opportunity we have at Canex, the people we are meeting, and take these things to the next level. Let's not just be, every year we're talking, we go to Cannes, we go to Berlin, we talk. Let's see these things happening, like it's already happening with the KZN and the Nigerian production that's happening very soon. So I just go straight to Moses now, and just the same thing, what are the limitations that you're facing in terms of your expansion pan-Africa?
The variety of challenges, not dissimilar to what Jackie has said, but I find that for the entertainment industry particularly, a lot of our governments in Africa have never really prioritized the sector.
Right.
And that's a big, it's a big challenge. And it affects so many things. But I also think it's a vicious cycle, because the industry itself has not been really well structured.
True.
So it's quite vicious. I think one of the challenges we've had when we set up the business was, I didn't think our guilds and associations were very strong. I didn't think that there was a real purpose. Over the last 12 to 18 months, I think that that's getting better. I think that professionalism is improving. I think that there's a tendency now for the industry, and speaking particularly with Nigeria, to almost speak with a voice. The cinemas have an exhibitors association. The producers, though from different parts of the country, seem to all be coordinated. It's very good to see that, you know, it's happening at this time where there's a lot of spotlight, you know, on creativity, you know, in Nigeria and on the continent. So I think that if our governments, you know, prioritize creativity, prioritize the fact that you could do a lot, you could impress your citizenry with prioritizing creativity, I think the better for a lot of them. I also think capital, deploying capital to the right segments in entertainment by working with the businesses that have, stuck their heads at it, you know, lost money but grown a business. We're here, TV Smooth Promotions, Film House, Silverbird. There are a number of companies across the continent that have really, you know, got out there, raised private equity capital, you know, and we're looking for more, and we're looking for people that can be brave enough to provide or inject this capital, you know, onto the continent. We've also had issues around specialization, like people understanding the skill set required. So if I want to release a film in Gabon, like, do I have a theatrical distribution partner who has done it for a while, who understands how to market that film product to the audience in Gabon? Or do I have that person in Togo? Or do I have that person in Rwanda, you know, for example, who has done it over time? Of course, you know, people need to build those skill sets, and that comes with training and a number of things. But one critical thing beyond the theatrical distribution side or physical cinema distribution side is also the strengthening of our IP laws. Whether it's Nigeria or whether it's, you know, other parts of the continent, once it's out of the cinema and it's on digital platforms or on TV, there is a real, you know, exploitation, illegal exploitation of a lot of the rights of various creators, whether it's film, TV, literature, the works. And I think that's something that we need to really decisively pursue. Using technology, using, you know, regulation, policy, all that kind of stuff, that is really in the way of getting, extracting the value that this entertainment sector on the continent has. So for me, those would be my, like, summary of things. There are other key little things like the cost of marketing or advertising, mm-hmm. of you know, for the sector. You know, those things are also in the way of real explosion. But like I said, if the people at the very top prioritize and see infrastructure is great and we want infrastructure, but you could make a whole lot of gains by a policy around encouraging the arts, encouraging entertainment. Right. You could make a big difference in 6 months, 12 months, you know, if people are doing it organically, you know, without support. Imagine if there was better enabling environment and there was cross-border cooperation. Mm-hmm. So I hope that the right people are listening and, yeah.
Thank you. So just to summarize what he said, first of all, there's need for capacity building within the continent, right? This is a very niche professional area. I know that a lot of times when we hear film, the only thing that comes to majority people is production. But production is just one leg. There's financing, there's distribution, right? So he is a distributor, and then he also sits in the production space. So we need to build capacity. There are people who specialization, and we call it the theory of transferable expertise. So you don't have to be a producer and then figure out how to distribute your movie. You can just focus on your production and have someone, a professional who understands distribution, working on that part for you. There are people whose job is to raise financing for your project. So you go speak to them, they understand it, they are the ones speaking to investors. So capacity building within this film business ecosystem is very important. Across distribution, production on one side, marketing, very important, film marketing, you know, taking your film as a product and running with it as a product, very, very important. And then, of course, what is the body language of the leaders of, you know, governments? I hope they are listening, like he said. right? You need to place priority. Whatever support that needs to happen quickly, because this is the time. You are seeing the scramble. There's so much attention on Africa at the moment from streamers, international streamers. We also need to wake up as Africans. We need to make sure that we take our positions, because if not, they've got the funding, they've got the finance. This finance we're talking about, this capital, they've got it, right? So if they're ready to, if they're coming to take over the continent, then I think it's something that we really need to watch out for. So thank you very much, Moses, for that contribution. And then I'll quickly ask Adeshun to also give us her own perspective. As, I mean, you've been in business for almost 15 years, right? Yes, you have evolved across. But if you're going to step out, if we're talking about Pan-African business, what are the limitations that you see to your type of business and space?
Okay, so thank you. Personally, I feel some limitations are created by ourselves. Now, there are too many CEOs than even workers around. It's crazy. CEO on Twitter, CEO on Instagram, CEO on what of you. They are everywhere, disrespecting entertainment and media, approaching everything in their own way, form and manner. So entertainment is fallback. Mm. Once you don't find success in banking, you start entertainment. Once you don't find success in your business, whether you're selling something or you're working for a multinational or you've saved enough money when you were working in oil and gas, you want to start a record label. So these things is a great challenge for us, because you're coming and you're not doing it professionally. Because you have the money, then you come and mess the whole system up and you make life difficult for us. I mean, we are the ones that are really doing this hard work. Just calm down. Let's do this business the right way. You know, if we begin to do every business the right way, I think some of the challenges that we find ourselves in, life would be a bit easy. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, because of a lot of unprofessionalism that is flying everywhere, it's a huge challenge on us. So when the real people that want to do the real thing are there, people don't pay attention, because it's either they don't look the parts or they don't have the resources to drive. Now, that is a part of it. Another part of it is, I think, those financial institutions and investors that are trying to come through should also take it easy on us. Mm. The requirements are crazy. Like, seriously, we are creative people. I think our requirements should actually be different from every other industry. Mm. So you can't begin to come to my industry and be asking me, we want to make a business case, you want to do a cash flow projection of, yes, we know it's Naira and Kobo, yes, we know what figures is, but try as much as possible to understand the trade. Maybe if you understand the trade, if you are giving every other person a moratorium period of 7 months, maybe you will give me 2 years moratorium period, because seriously, sometimes before this thing flesh out and it becomes money, it takes time, if you understand. If you want to do it, you have to do it right, and you have to do it well. That's about it.
Thank you. Thank you so much. This is very interesting. And I also believe that, you know, one of the challenges we're also having within the continent is there's no really structured growth process, right? So somebody can work on a project today as an assistant, and then a couple of more projects, and next thing, he's looking for who to raise money from. Are you going to be experimenting on people's money? You see what I mean? So it's important that across Africa, he said something about professionalism, the guilds, the associations. Let's begin to have structure in place before someone can come out and say, producer, I'm a producer. What have you done? What is the process? Because at the end of the day, it's also going to affect the output, what we are seeing, you know, what we're getting out of our different industries. That is very, very important. Right. And I really want to say thank you to all of us. I will open the floor for questions, but I just want to, let me take questions, then I'll take one more because of our time. Yes, questions, okay. We can start from the lady, yes. Have you got a mic?
Mm-hmm. just want to ask a question, obviously.
Can you tell us your name, where you're from?
Oh, I'm Crystal, I'm from Durban.
Okay.
And I am based in media and content production. But as a youth, obviously we are the future of all of these industries. But one thing I find quite intimidating for someone my age coming into an industry like film is how do we come in when there's already industry leaders, and how do we make the space for the youth without feeling like we have to match up to them, and how do we create that space for ourselves?
Moses, do you have opportunities for next-gen producers? Do you give them this kind of opportunity that they need, or you just only work with the established, the big guys?
Well, that's a good question, and thank you for asking it. From our perspective, I would like to say we're not discriminatory as the Film House Group. We have a workforce of almost 500 people across the group, and a large portion of that are the next gen, the young people. The leadership of the company is young. In terms of like content creation, our approach is more where we can get formal training, institutions. Our approach is to encourage apprenticeships, encourage internships, find ways of filtering from a lot of people want to be part of the creative process, has been mentioned. A lot of people want to get into entertainment, but it's our job to also try and find the right kind of people, the right kind of mix. And so what we try to do is, reach out, make sure we're very active on the digital platforms, and then find, people there and allocate them to our production and give them an opportunity for internships and apprenticeships. And because we're very aware that we need to have a pipeline for us to have a sustainable industry, an industry that will be here for decades to come, we need to ensure we give people chances now, otherwise we would not have a business. So we're very, very aware of that. One thing we've not done very well, I have to confess, in the last 5 years, is maybe prioritizing things about young, adults in our films or their representation in it. And that's something that we're looking to visit properly.
Creating content that speaks to
that speaks to that audience, and also ensuring that we love the streamers, we love what they're coming to do, but ensuring that we can do it authentically, we can do it, ourselves. That's something. Again, I'm speaking as a company now. I don't know how the wider industry sees it, but that's something we're looking to.
I think I completely share in this perspective, because even with the summit before now, it was just top executive, business owners, investors come together. But the last summit we had in Lagos in September, for the first time, we had a next-gen focus session, and they were super excited. They were happy that they could actually come to and meet people that they look up to in the industry, like you said, have a platform to express themselves, right? Talk about their problems, their issues. Really, it took me some time to get to this point to say, I think we need to pay attention. That's the summary of what we're saying. Yes, there is an opportunity to be given to them, because these are the people you're going to hand over to, right? So it's important we start now to educate them, to empower them, to build the right capacity. Because there's a lot of knowledge gap as far as the business side is concerned. There's a lot. A lot of people don't understand what distribution is. They don't understand marketing and so on and so forth. So yes, it's something that we all need to just continue to do. I think Jackie also talked about trainings that you're doing for young people, right?
Absolutely. We've got a very big focus on youth as the KZN Film Commission. We start with school learners. We've got a schools program specifically for schools children, just to show them what careers are available in film.
I see.
And they also get an opportunity to make their own film. We've got a bursary program, like I've mentioned, but we've also got a graduate program where we actually take the graduates and give them their first sort of real-life work experience. It's a three-year program that really prepares them for the industry. Once they exit that program, we also then put them on internships, like Moses is saying, and also just try and secure employment for them in different parts of the industry.
So I think
we've
this
got a
is
small
important.
Business development yeah. program, also yeah. for youth and for women. So we've got a big youth focus.
Precisely as possible. There used to be a concern whether that demographic really had the purchasing power for the type of things we were doing. But it's changing now, you know, because, you know, you guys
actually
are...
actually controlling the narrative.
Yeah, disrupting technology.
That's actually my own focus. Okay. So my target audience is 16 to 35, mm-hmm. and those that are youthful at heart. I don't deal with old people.
Yes, it's changing. So before now, it was like, would they afford, would they prioritize that Naira, come to the cinema, mm-hmm. you know, you would, but now you have to, you know, you have to change your thinking. And thank you for, you know, confirming our thoughts and asking the question.
Thank you. So can we have the question from the gentleman here? Yes.
Hi, everybody. My name is Bapna Dahan. I'm originally from Chad, but I'm French, so I'm from the diaspora. And I heard you mentioning Cannes, and actually the reason why I came here is I happen to be good friends with Spike Lee. So I was with him in 2018 for the Cannes Film Festival.
Okay.
I was with him this year again. And the reason why I'm here is we're a group of people in the US and in Ghana. Next year in Cannes, we are putting together what I call a celebration of Black excellence in creative industry.
Right.
And I heard the lady speaking about the Kesiden Film Commission. And my point really is to bring a collaboration between the African diaspora. Mm. And coming from Lyon, you know, Thierry Frémaux, Stu Lumière. So the reason why we thought about this thing is to bring Lyon, because it's where I grew up, as a platform to collaborate with different French alliances in all African countries in order to allow people to get scholarship to come and study film in Lyon or in the US. So as she was speaking, I just sent Spike Lee the video of what she was saying, because he's also teaching at the NYU film.
Absolutely.
So I want to speak with you afterwards in order to create that this network of the next talented filmmakers. I always say that the USA are multinational. They sell, their biggest marketing is their culture. And Hollywood is the marketing tool for America.
Mm-hmm.
And now we also need to have our own version of, to in order to change the perception.
Absolutely.
And the film is the only way to change perception.
Absolutely.
When I'm finished on this. I was really surprised when Black Panther came out. Surprised about how they were reacting to the outfits, you know. And I mentioned to my white folks that this is how we dress all the time. We didn't wait Black Panther to know that we're dressing like this.
Yes, so absolutely.
It's glad that Black Panther allowed you to understand that this is how we are.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And I finish on Black Panther. Technically, next year, we're gonna also put together a tribute to Chadwick Boseman. So I would love to discuss with you afterwards.
Fantastic.
To make it happen for 2022.
Thank you. Thank you. I mean, nice to know that we have in this hall people who have very similar interests, and that is what we remain committed to do: to drive conversations, to build those bridges, making this networking possible, so that, like I said, we have to be very intentional, very, very intentional. So I'm very excited at what you're doing, very commendable. And I see things happening between, even with the summit, the next gen we're doing, and what KZN is actually doing. So thank you very much for that contribution. Okay, yes, I have another question.
Okay, thank you very much. Greetings to everyone. I'm Petzile, I'm from Swaziland. I'm in the entrepreneurship space, but I'm also a gospel artist. I like the discussions. They are so much eye-opening. And I'm happy that we've taken time to appreciate the talent that we have as Africa. And it is really saddening to see other continents appreciating Africa more than we appreciate ourselves, because of the resources that God has given us in terms of talent. It has already been mentioned that the art and creative space lacks professionalism.
Mm-hmm.
It lacks building. There's an imbalance across the continent. It would be really good for this forum to decentralize the programs to the whole of Africa so that where the talent is less appreciated, they can realize there's more that can be done. Like in my country, I think art is the most suffering industry right now.
Yeah.
Because it's the appreciation and the prioritization that doesn't happen. So it's at the bottom of the list of industries that need support right now. Yet we all can see that COVID has really broken down the livelihood of the art industry as a whole. So I'm happy with the issue of scholarships that KZN has come up with, because the future of the industry, that the professionalism and the capacity building, it needs to be formalized, and the stream needs to be very clear that this is what one is supposed to do. And starting at a very low age to build the talent is a very good model, but then also having the understanding of the financiers about the industry itself.
Absolutely.
Those who are giving out loans, they don't understand the industry. They keep asking you a lot of questions that you can't even answer, because they are treating you like a normal business, yet it's a very totally different business type of a concept. So
thank you
for the discussions.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I just want to also speak to what Jackie said, and Jackie, in some of your efforts towards capacity building for young people, I hope you're also prioritizing the business side. I hope you're talking to them about distribution, about financing, because really, this aspect of the business side, there's little or no attention that has been paid before now, and that is why we keep we work with Film One, Film House, organizing different conferences in different parts, in different countries, just to bring this awareness that, look, this is a business, and if we're not structured, these financiers will not take us serious. So it's a chicken and egg situation, isn't it? So you need to, for them to take you seriously, you need to demonstrate that you've got the capacity for what you're doing. And how do you demonstrate that you have capacity? You must also have structure as a business, right, in place. So I think these are the boxes that we need to tick, and I'm looking forward to having more and more collaborations where we can share knowledge, where we can leverage on our strengths, building this very, very needed capacity within the industry. Thank you. So we'll just take one more question because of our time.
Okay. That cinema is not dead, and that while streamers are doing very good work with getting content to audiences, there is still a real need for cinemas to be around. Would you please expand on that? It would be really interesting to hear.
All right.
Thanks for a great session.
All right, thank you. So like my colleague said here, it's good to maybe talk numbers. Prior to COVID, and I'll speak specifically to Nigeria, where massively on the screen nation, but we've seen a lot of potential. Between 2015 and 2019, cinemas were growing in Nigeria between 25 and 35%. That is like, that's an insanely ridiculous growth rate. Between 2015, 2016, I think it was between 2018 and, actually 2018 and 2019 that we saw a bit of a slowdown, and that was because of an election year. So all the metrics possible, average ticket price, number of tickets sold, value of box office in dollars and in naira was going up, despite even the foreign exchange issues. Of course, 2020, as everybody says, is the reset year. That's the year of the disruption. That's the year of the end of cinema. Well, all the indicators we're seeing, again in Nigeria, if you look at the stats, I think around the world, the recovery rate is about something about 50 to 60%, depending on the territory, of 2019's numbers. Well, in Nigeria, it's about 85%.
Wow.
You know, and a lot of that, let me also mention that the biggest, highest grossing film of all time was released December 25, 2 of COVID, right? That film has gone on to do $635 million, right? That's over $1 million. That's in less than 70 cinemas, right?
every metric possible just tells you that people want to have, you know, this new out-of-home experience.
Right.
And if you build the right kind of cinemas in the right environments, and we're still talking about affluent, middle-class type cinemas. We've not talked about cinemas that are more affordable, right? Nobody, I mean, for me, just looking at South Africa, you know, I know it's tough. I'm not trying to get distracted. I see opportunities in the townships. You know, nobody has quite done that. I think it will be tricky. I would like to prove a model in Nigeria first to bring. But just even looking at the middle to upper class, we have in Lagos about 25 cinemas. Lagos can take 50. You know, Lagos accounts for 45% of the box office in West Africa, right? We're seeing in outside Lagos, Ibadan, Abuja, Benin, you know, Akure. These are centers that consume local products majorly, 50% of their box office, majorly. Abuja, about exclude Abuja and Port Harcourt. These are urban centers. So there's a good mix between Hollywood and, Hollywood and Nollywood. So every metrics we've looked at in the recovery year, in a, you know, in the pandemic, tells us that, you know, the cinema is alive and well from everything we're looking. December is a few weeks away. I mean, that would be a critical time again to tell us how the diaspora coming in would also spend. But everything we've seen, you know, for the first year in a while, Nollywood is going to account for about 45% of box office. The highest number before that was in 2017, and that was about 38%, right? You can argue that Hollywood was not releasing films in the first quarter of the year and all that kind of stuff, but Hollywood has also had its good comeback with, you know, the likes of Black Widow, Fast and Furious, you know, Dune, James Bond, all that kind of stuff. But in Nigeria, what we're just saying is give them a great experience, give them a great film, market it well. The film doesn't even have to be fantastic. It just has to be well marketed, decent enough for them to watch, people to talk about. You know, and this is what's keeping us bullish. Call me sentimental, call me passionate. The numbers tells me that, you know, it's working. It's also important for it to work because we need to prove that a local market exists for not just our content, but just like the business in general.
Yep.
The local market gives us a lot more leverage. I prove to you, a streamer, that I can generate $1 million in transactions for a film. You want to take my film globally? I have leverage. But if you take it and just look at it and value it on your own, you can use your own metrics, but nothing tells you that it's going to succeed. You don't have that much leverage.
Absolutely.
So, glad to say, practically, it's working, but it's important for it to work forward. I hope it helps.
Thank you. It's important to work. Please, can you just make it very brief?
Yes, I will. My name is Idris. I'm the host of the Smasher Show on Horizon Radio 104.3 FM. And my question is, how does one distribute and monetize micro contents like music videos across Africa in the age of payola? Thank you.
Okay, so this is not a music panel. So I'm not sure.
I said music video, micro video content.
So that would be you, music videos. You do a lot with music.
Okay, so first, for our kind of music video that would play on the channel, we let people understand that it is not monetary, right? Reason why is because you pay close attention to the content, the production first, before the monetary angle, right? So it's easy. All you just need to do is to map out what your plans are. There's a platform that when they want to generate revenue for music video, they sell it out to some platforms. It could be the Boomplay, it could be YouTube and the likes. Now, as an artist, you must also understand where your market is. Are you getting me? So because you have some, because the truth about the matter is, all this music video thing, that's not where the money is. Oh.
Trust me, don't be deceiving yourself. Because if you think it's a music video, it's just an English word. That's not where the money is. Most of these artists is deals.
Yeah.
Deals from brands. They sign contracts. Big brands endorse them. So what the music video does is it puts them on the advertorial level. It exposes them to the world. But if you are acting hungry and you are saying bring money for music video, at the end of the day, you collect money for music video, nobody will call you for a show. And you won't make any money. So just get the business model right. Let the music video be everywhere. However, be intentional and have strategic deals with brands, multinationals, people that can give you good money, that you can be signing 3-year contract on one particular music video, brands that will endorse an artist and will be paying so much money based on a particular song, that even that song, you'll be using it as a theme song for another brand. Take, for example, from my country, a Davido or a Wizkid. Across globally, you understand now? So please play it low on monetizing music video because you shot the video after all. Just ensure that the video is good and the artist can stand the test of time. Don't just come and say, oh, music video. And at the end of the day, 1 year, 2 years, the artist is nowhere to be found. Let them do shows. Let them sign deals. Be strategic. Position them well. That one, it will stand the test of time.
Thank
well
you. Said. Well Thank said. You. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you for listening. I hope you had a great time. We will just be wrapping up, and just in 1 minute, what is the support that you need to move some of these plans to the next level? I mean, you've already made appreciable progress in the different things you're doing, but what is that one thing, that support that is lacking that will really help push up what you're trying to achieve?
I would say it's collaborations, it's partnerships. I do believe that governments need to be involved to incentivize and support the industry and nurture the industry. I think it's something that is lacking on the continent, you know, government having an active role in the film industry. It'll just alleviate, it'll make all of our work easier. Yes, the business side is very important. It's very important to have well-structured film businesses. Mm-hmm. We do have film business development programs specifically because, without that, you're not able to grow an economy.
Absolutely.
So creating jobs definitely is critical. But, collaboration and, I will really just end it government support. Let's have more governments incentivizing, supporting, and helping to grow the industries across the continent, because with that we can look at collective strategies that actually address specific areas that we need to press on, focus on, build markets across the continent. But if we're doing it in little silos, little pockets, we won't really have the impact that we need to really fast track the growth of this industry.
Thank you for that last word, Jackie and Moses.
I think everything Jackie said, but I focus on training, capacity building, and even at the very elementary level. So, looking at our curriculums, looking at our, education from a young age. Let's stop this thing where entertainment is meant for riffraffs. I think that's changing. I think that that's going to be critical to ensure that we don't, this is not a one-off. Right, we have this great timing, everything is working across various creative sectors. So we just need to ensure that we're building for tomorrow.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Moses. Thank you. Adeshino?
Okay, for me, so I'll be very straightforward. You're an investor out there and you want to make good money. I've already told you guys, in the next 5 years, go and write it down. This is the gold mine, E&M, entertainment and media. You really want to make good money, you want to make sense out of your business, walk up to me and let's have a conversation. It's as easy as that.
Thank you, and thank you, and thank you again. So, on our side, we're having a masterclass, a film business masterclass on Friday, the 18th, and it's by 11 o'clock. Jackie, it would be good to have some of your students. And really, when I looked at the presentation, I asked myself, I hope this is as simple as possible because we really need to start you know, from the very basic. Myself and Moses here will be facilitating that film business. It's actually for the next generation, like you said, you know. Yes, and I'm hoping, we want you to have an in-depth understanding of film business opportunities and the possibilities, the challenges for the next gen African producers. So please spread the word. That is all part of the efforts that we are making. We are being very deliberate in building capacity across Africa. And as many who you think can benefit from this masterclass, please encourage them to be part of it. It's not every time that you see a Moses out here to share his knowledge, you know. And so we are looking forward to that. I want to say a very big thank you to everyone here this evening. Thank you for sparing this time to listen to us. Thank you for the conversations. And we're looking forward to more collaborations happening, that when we are coming again for Canex, we can say, oh, this was an offshoot of Canex 2021. That is the testimonies that we're looking for. And I want to thank you, the organizers. Thank you for this platform. Yes. Thank you for giving us the opportunity to come have these conversations. Right. It's very, it's a right step in the right direction, and we'll keep building and building and building on it. On this note, I want to say thank you, and do have a great evening.
Ladies and gents, if you've been with us since this morning, I'm sure you can attest that every single speech and every single panel discussion that we've had today has just been getting better and better. We're learning and we're growing so much. Now, this next chat is something I'm very, very excited about, and I hope you guys will be too. But before we get into that, please make sure that you stay around. We have the Afriksim cocktail party that is going to be right here in this venue. It's an opportunity for us to meet each other, to network, and to really do what it is that we came here to do, which is to connect, to network, and hopefully to grow and collaborate together. So please make sure that you do stay for our cocktail party. It will be right here. And it is open to everyone who is able and willing to share this incredible event with us. Now, wisdom does not come overnight, and when you come into contact with it, show deference. We are extremely proud of our very first giant of the Canex Live Theatre, Mr. Alex Okosi. The African music ecosystem that has given rise to the likes of Burna Boy, Diamond Platnum, Yemi Alade, greatly owed the successful evolution to Alex's journey and vision. To moderate this special fire chat, please welcome my very dear friend. He is an African superstar, media personality, and media mogul. He is the CEO of Light Communications, and I'm sure you've seen him on your screens maybe once or twice. Please welcome onto stage my friend, IK Osaki Odua.
How you guys doing? All right, I know many of you heard about the fireside chat that I was going to have with Monsieur Didier Drogba, and a few of you Chelsea fans are here. Hoping for, now unfortunately, due to logistic reasons, Monsieur Didier Jokba, I don't talk like this normally, I'm just messing around. Didier unfortunately could not make it because logistically it just didn't work out to put him here in time for this. I must apologize, he's not here. But this is called When Giants Speak, right? And we found a giant that Minnie has already introduced. And this man is no meager individual. He is someone that you definitely need to sit at the feet of, learn wisdom from. He's pan-African in his expression, in his career. And you're going to learn quite a bit from him. And Minnie, just by the way, I love you. Thank you so much for that great introduction. I love you. Please put your hands together for Minnie Dlamini Jones. Minnie Dlamini Jones. Join me in welcome Nigerian-born, U.S.-trained media executive, someone who brought you The Mamas, brought you MTV Base Africa, brought you Nickelodeon, and Comedy Central. Join me in welcome Alex Okosi. Put your hands together for him. Definitely a giant in his own right. Alex, take a seat. Yes. Thank you. Now, I want to be clear and be honest, because we, up until the last minute, were still trying to make it happen with Didier and it didn't work out. Alex had absolutely no notice that I was going to bring him up here to speak. He had no knowledge before 15 minutes ago that we would be doing this interview.
Maybe an hour.
But he's been gracious enough to accept, so... Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
Now, this is called When Giants Speak. Now, the problem with listening to giants, and I think many people here would agree, is that when you see somebody who has been wildly successful in whatever career, you don't relate to them. You admire them, you appreciate what they've achieved, but it's hard to relate with them because in your mind, they were never regular human beings. So I guess my first question was, have you always been like a high flyer? Were you that straight A student? Were you that guy who aced your university degree to the extent that the president wrote you a letter congratulating you, valedictorian and all of that? What were your early days like?
I was that guy. No, on a more serious note, yes. Look, what I'm very confident about is that I worked hard. I'm very confident that I was very lucky and had amazing people that I've worked with throughout the years that believed in what we wanted to do and believed in that mission, right? So those are some of the things that I know to be true. Through the hard work, obviously, as you say, you find success, but I don't think there's a prerequisite to, you know, being a valedictorian or having a successful academic career that means that you're going to be great at what you do. I think a lot of it has to be with what you believe in, what your values are, and more importantly, being able to actually get people to buy into the mission or the dream that you have, and then them actually being willing to, you know, rock up every day with you and deliver. There's nothing that I've ever accomplished that I would say I did by myself, and I've just been blessed throughout with that opportunity. And I've also met people that a lot of the things that people also don't speak to often is people that they admire or people that inspire them or people that mentor them. I've also been lucky to have that throughout my career. So I think those are some of the things that I think are the foundations to what it is. I mean, I grew up in Nigeria from until age 12. I went to the U.S. and lived all over the U.S. before graduating and being able to start at MTV. So my journey is as humble as it comes.
Let me jump in here. First of all, before I go back into the interview with him, just to qualify him for those of you who may not be millennials or Gen Z and are not familiar with the vast success of the man that's sitting next to me, he was the brain and the driving force that brought us MTV Base, right? So, which is the equivalent, yes. Which is the equivalent of MTV Europe's Urban Music Service, right? He was the creative mind and the driving force as well behind what became the MTV Africa Music Award, the Mamas, right? That was his job as well. He localized a lot of their content, Nickelodeon, Comedy Central, and his career has been successful, not just for him, but for many Africans, it's been beneficial for us as well, because he helped bring that intra-Africa music competition and collaboration that elevated us to proper global positioning, so that African music now, we have Burna Boys and people who are placing not just locally or continentally, but internationally. So I just wanted you to know the gentleman that I'm speaking with, so that you can hear and appreciate when he spits wisdom, which he does ever so eloquently and casually. But speaking about your career and joining in with MTV Base, there are different people here. Some people are creative, some people are just fresh out of university, some people are trying to start a business and scale it. How did you, yeah, it's okay, that's good luck. All right, how did you get into the positions you got into at MTV Base? Thousands of people must
have. Well, listen, again, I got out of university in the US, and I was really fortunate because I was an international student. So being an international student means that you get a job for a year and then you go back home,
yeah,
right? And hadn't been there, I literally got to the US when I went on holiday with my parents at age 12. And I told them they had to leave me behind. And of course, my mother said, over my dead body. That was but I convinced her, because I was pointing to the immediate older brother who couldn't get a visa to study in the US anymore, because they started making it harder for university students. So after convincing my mother with my dad, I was left behind with my oldest brother, who he didn't know, him and his wife didn't know they were going to inherit a 12-year-old. But anyway, I was focused on my dream. So after doing that, one of the things that really sort of drove me early on was trying to figure out, how do we change the narrative on Africa? There's nothing more torturous than being a 12-year-old African kid in America. Because everyone thought that you came from the jungle.
Where'd you get your clothes?
They thought I had a pet lion. They thought that you didn't have any clothes, you were starving and dying. So for me, you know, it really, really at an early age inspired me to figure out, how do we start to be able to change the narrative on the continent and tell a different story? And that always stuck to me. So, you know, to be honest with you, digging in the classroom and trying to make sure I'm the best student was to basically say to them, I can't be from the jungle if I'm beating you in the math and English classes, right?
Yeah.
This is a real special jungle kid then. So that was one of the things that was also motivated, beyond the fact that, you know, of course, education is a really important part of our family upbringing.
Yeah.
So being very fortunate and getting my first gig out of college at MTV was an opportunity to do that. You know, MTV for us at the time had localized channels around the world, with the exception of Africa. And for me, that was an opportunity to show the world what we call the reimagined Africa, before people started using the word reimagined all the time, to be able to just sort of show the non-CNN version of the continent. And I knew that the only way to do that was to be able to showcase our youth culture. Now, to start that, to be quite honest, it was difficult at the time, right? Because A, you had to prove, how do you launch a business in Africa in the media space, an MTV business? Because the business model didn't support it, right? The pay TV platform that was dominant had their own sort of music channel that only sort of promoted South African content. I wanted to show the world all of Africa's content. And how do you make money doing it, especially in a marketplace where that wasn't going to support it? So we had to think differently about, how do you do this? You know, take some of this content and put it on free-to-air TV. So thank God, my mentor, your former chairman, Ben Burry Bruce, bought into the vision and did our first deal where we actually had a block of MTV Base that was TV, right? So that was one of the things that I built into the plan. And then when you piece that all that together with pay TV revenue, et cetera, all of a sudden it became a business that was going to be profitable. In 3 years was the story I was telling Viacom, right? And had to now sell. I know I wrote at least 30 different versions of this business plan, because I sold it to everyone and their mama that would listen. And when they bit into the plan and they believed in it, you know, I put together a real small team of people, but...
Wait, hang on. I'm sorry. I let you go. You're just going to tell the story, tell the history, and just, you know, like... But I wanted to zero in on this pitch, right? And please, a round of applause to the gentleman he just spoke about, Ben Murray Bruce, over there. Genius mind, single-handedly revived the cinema culture in Nigeria. So you heard from Moses Babatokwe earlier, who's with Film House. All the other cinemas are beneficiaries of his particular drive, and he redefined TV and radio in Nigeria as well over the last 20 years. Good to have you with us, sir. But I want you to zero in on that. Now, even though not everybody here is in music, everybody here has a product, has something that they want to pitch to the rest of the world, right? How do you pitch Africa? Because that's what you essentially did. You took Africa and pitched it to the company. How do you pitch Africa to a company that is successful and doesn't need particularly the market, doesn't feel they need the market, or may not be interested? How do you pitch Africa?
I mean, you have to pitch it as a business proposition, right? So for me, the worst thing you can ever do is to say, let's be in Africa because it's the only place left for us to be in. No one was going to buy that, right? And for me, the kumbaya aspect of it will never be a sustainable model. Because what the vision was, how do you truly elevate African youth culture globally, across Africa and globally? So it was actually making sure that you built a business that said, this is who's going to be your customers, this is how you're going to make money, and this is how sustainable it was going to be over a period of time. And this is how you're going to, because at the time, the difficulty was, how are you going to put music content on a channel where the music content was really not of great quality?
Yeah.
So how do you solve for that? And that's what I was going to say earlier was, we have to figure out how to solve for the product itself. If you were launching a music service, an MTV service in Spain or Italy, you just go, you get a music videos from the label, you put it in, and you have a channel. We had to actually educate the market. We had to do music workshops. We had to produce free music videos. We had to create partnerships. People at the time were laughing, like, Alex, what? How's MTV going to partner with Shell? I'm like, they have money. I have a platform. They are interested in being able to help Africa. For me, the best way to help Africa is to create an industry for the youth.
Yeah.
To do that, we wanted to show how you can get this music to travel. To create an African music industry that will travel, you needed to have the music video, which is the most powerful piece of marketing music, like, to have it be something that people will want to see. When I was doing research, which was kind of like makeshift research, kids will laugh at content from other countries. If it was a Congolese video, they'll laugh about how they're standing in front of a pool doing the two-step. They laughed about the quality. So for us, we knew that was the first thing to do was to solve the quality challenge. So we had to actually produce, teach, educate people to be able to produce to that standard. And once we did that, people started producing music videos for MTV Base. The industry got lifted. The young kid that's in Tanzania can now see a Nigerian artist. The South African artist can now be seen in Nigeria. And it started to create an industry where these artists started to collaborate, started to get gigs in other markets, and it was a powerful promotional tool. That was kind of like our first step, establishing the video industry market for music in Africa.
And that was phenomenal because I remember back then as a radio DJ, one of our DJs had gotten into the you guys were training people to make music videos, and he started taking the training, and he moved to South Africa, became one of the big music producers here, and video producers, and he became something huge internationally. But think of it now, right? In Nigeria, I can't speak to all of Africa, but in Nigeria, research is a problem because we don't collect data, right? You're making this proposal about these will be your customers, but you don't have data. This is how much we will grow, but you don't have data. So how did you draw that proposal that works when your data is speculative?
Well, listen, my data wasn't speculative. It just wasn't readily available to the world, right? So South African data, because they had a very established advertising industry, because, I mean, for me, I was doing TV, right, but music TV. You can deduct how much revenues was going into the TV space. Nigeria, the data was there, right, but it was very local. So I must be honest, I got real lucky. In all my research, I found a person whose father was running one of the biggest agencies in the country, the advertising agencies in the country. He connected me to the dad. He saw that I wasn't chasing his daughter. So and he believed in my vision. So he actually made his whole agency available to me in terms of me being able to mine the advertising data that they had locally. So combining that with the South African data I had, I was able to at least start building the foundation for what the potential revenue model was going to be from an advertising space. So data was available locally, but I had to now make sure that I found it not through the traditional means of just sitting behind a desk. I had to come into market, build relationships, get the information. But more importantly, it's not just also about data, but to get a feel of the appetite, right? So when I spoke to you about the research that we did, I literally sat with kids in this makeshift focus groups, from kids from Unilag and, you know, some of the people that worked for me in the early days were people I found in those focus groups that will bring together kids and sort of figure out what will it take to build a youth culture channel that they could all enjoy that was Pan-African.
Yeah. Now, the research, how long did that stage take? Because most of us only saw you at the execution. That's what we noticed. But how long is that process for you?
Look, I when I convinced the company to sort of at least think about it, it wasn't my job, right? I literally was able to get join our strategy and biz dev team in London, and I was moonlighting my Africa business plan. But it took a good year for me to figure it out. I traveled to everywhere from Senegal to Dar es Salaam to Accra to Lagos to Kampala, Nairobi, literally trying to understand how we can make it work and also trying to make sure that this thing, people will be excited to see it. The one thing that was really helpful was to see that young Africans actually wanted to see themselves, but they wanted to see themselves in a much better light, which was, you know, tied into the mission that we had.
Okay, now you spoke to something that I want to address quickly. You talked about lifting the standard, elevating the content. Now at the time, music videos were not great and needed help across Africa, the entire space. Maybe South Africa was probably further advanced than we were, a lot more advanced than we were. How do you fund that part of it? Training people to do videos for other people. How do you fund that process?
That's what I told you. We were very lucky. We came up with a proposal for how we would partner with Shell to uplift Africa's youth through music. And we pitched them this idea of funding this, right? Because again, I'm running a media business. You want to bring money in, right? to make it work. So we pitched them that idea and they bought into it. And so we spent 2 years, you know, going to different cities from you know, in Gabon to Ghana to, again, Nigeria to South Africa, Kenya, Tanzania, and we did this Making the Music Video workshops. And we brought in the best of the best international producers in what we call these skills exchange workshops, because we felt like there was so much they can learn from our artists as well. And they literally directed some really definitive music videos at the time with all these directors that were African directors learning how to create better content. And at the time, it wasn't about how much money you spent in the videos. That's what's kind of the output of it. Our directors thought it was getting the nice car, the girl in the mini skirt, you had a nice video. It wasn't about that. It was teaching about how to light better, make sure your sound, how to concept what you're going to do, how to create those visual effects that kind of raises the standard. So that's kind of the work that was done in the beginning. And then, you know, we also took our time to go out and do a lot of live events. And those live events, again, were also money generators, but at the same time, opportunities for us to capture content to be able to promote the artist.
You're covering it, but I think what I'm asking is, how do you get Shell, an oil company, who isn't looking to sell to your clients, nor are they really keen on the advertising, how do you get Shell to put money in that's not going to bring money back to Shell? Because everybody here represents a business that needs funding. How do I make someone, how do I show them something in it for them that doesn't boil down to dollars and pounds and naira?
Well, I mean, I think at the end of the day, there's obviously the value, the brand association and value that Shell was going to get, right? Shell was going to be able to sort of, in a lot of ways, be able to uplift its image by being seen as a brand that's not just taken from the continent, but that's also contributing to the development of her youth, right? So for them, that was the real value. So it wasn't about selling them they're going to get more, you know, sell more oil products, but it was about being able to demonstrate to them the value that they will get and the goodwill they will get and the association they will get from being seen as an enabler of Africa's youth versus, you know, people that are coming just to take. So not every association or sponsorship, you know, to answer your question, you know, at the time was really about, I must get this back. You know, some brands also understand the real value of the association in terms of, you know, how, you know, what it adds to their image and reputation.
Okay, now, thank you for that. And that's still, I believe, something that is in every big corporate's budget, something to help with their PR, their imaging, so it's something that people can still reach to that same angle for funding. But every good business wants to scale, right? You want to go beyond proof of concept that I can do this. This can be a great channel, or this can be a great music video, or this can be a great music career, to making it acceptable to everybody. You did that with channels, with platforms. How do you scale? What's the first thing you want to think about when you're taking your business from your, whether it's a music career, whether it's a record label, cinemas, from that place where you're the local player to continent level play?
It's about starting with a mindset that you're not just trying to satisfy the local market. You build a 3-5 year plan for a business versus building a plan that just kind of keeps you alive. Because if you're just trying to build a business that stays alive 3 years from now, chances are you're going to fail. But if you're trying to build an ambitious business plan that says these are some of the things that you're going to put in place to grow it over a long-term period, you now start thinking about who are all your potential customers, right? So it's first of all trying to think about who are all your potential customers. And that's the reason why I get excited, even more excited about where I am today. Like, I feel like I've done it on the, you know, traditional media side, and now I'm at YouTube, and the excitement is 2 billion people access YouTube on a monthly basis. 500 hours of content gets uploaded every minute on YouTube. You have, for the creator that's local here, for the musician, you have access to quite a huge number of people. So as you are a creator or whatever you're using creativity for as an example, you have to be thinking about how do you reach as many people as possible that can have an appetite for what you are creating. So for me, it's being able to build that plan that really considers all the opportunities you have and all the sort of, you know, sort of complementary sort of platforms that will enable you to get there.
I'm definitely going to get to your time, your current career, which is YouTube and Google. But before then, I want you spend some time building things on platforms like Sugar, which also at the time was a deviation from what you had become known for on the continent. And it was socially conscious. It didn't seem like it was just entertainment. Why was that important for you at the time to put out content that was socially responsible? I mean, it's understandable, but why was it important for an entertainment business to suddenly become socially relevant with socially conscious content with Sugar? Then you had financial literacy with Nickelodeon. Why was that important? And does that help the bottom line?
All of it helps, but more importantly, I mean, I think that, again, it was part of the mission, right? So I can't say that it was all me, because MTV was always at the zeitgeist of youth culture by making sure that it wasn't just an entertainment platform, but that we spoke to the cultural issues that affected young people, right? So for me, looking at how we address those on the continent, the issue of sexual health, of course, was really important to us. And Sugar was our drama series. If you guys don't know it, it's amazing that continues till today, that we created out of MTV on the continent, out of Africa. We wanted to be able to get kids to be more responsible about about their sexual behavior. But we didn't feel like PSAs were going to be effective in doing that. So we, through our partnerships with funders, the Gates Foundation, etc., we're able to raise funds to create this really powerful award-winning drama series that really put kids in experiences and situations when you watch these dramas that they can relate to. And from what they see, they can understand the impact of the decisions that they make and then be able to start thinking about how they make sure that they don't get themselves in those situations. Sugar was powerful for us in that way. So it met a whole bunch of our mission of making sure that we didn't just entertain, but we also edutained, and that we were in a platform that wasn't just powerful, but also wasn't powerful in a lot of ways, right? So that's kind of why, you know, initiatives like Sugar was really important to us. you know, around every single election, we had our choose or lose campaigns where we interviewed whoever the, you know, the presidential candidates were in South Africa. We did Julius Malema, Jacob Zuma, Helen Zille. In Nigeria, we did President Jonathan. We did that as well, where we had young people sit with those leaders and ask them those questions. So it was important for us that we made sure that young people had a voice and MTV wasn't just a platform to educate. So that's really why we did that. You know, for me, I still get excited today when I sit and I read about Lupita Nyong'o saying that she got an acting break on Sugar. Some of y'all don't know that, but that was her real first acting chops. Yeah. That excites me, right? Because she's now an incredible example for what you can be as a young African actress,
yeah.
Right? So for me, all of it just comes together so beautifully, but I think it still has to start, you know, start with you having truly an authentic mission to do something great, but also to have a team of people that are going to come up with the juice, because, you know, I had the best people, man.
That's nice. It's nice that you give them credit as well. So I only have about 30 minutes more, but you have to address something for all of us. Now you're with YouTube, you're with Google. How do you get the big corporates to partner with you or to fund various products? What are you guys looking for?
Look, for us on the YouTube side, I mean, I think our mission is really to be able to provide a voice to, you know, to our creators and artists around the world, right? I think that what excites me is that they've taken the African, I still have Africa as part of my territories, right?
Yeah.
So beyond the other markets I look after, I'm still passionate about here, and I'm excited to be here. And I, for instance, believe it or not, guys, this is my first day meeting my new head for South Africa, Zef, that I hire virtually. Zef, say hi. So again,
sorry to interrupt you. Just to put that in context for you, he's in charge of partnerships for teams in Russia, Middle East, and Africa.
Yep. Russia, Middle East, Africa, Turkey, Israel. You know. We're trying. But Africa is in my heart, so you know, that's where we at.
Okay, so how do we take advantage of the fact that you are, like you said, Africa is in your heart? What does that mean when you say teams are partnering, your partnerships and everything? How do we get Google in the room? How do we get into the room with Google?
Google's already in the room. A few weeks ago, we just announced $1 billion investment that we're putting into Africa over the next few years. That's going to not just be us, just, you know, it's our partnerships with small businesses. There's different initiatives that are part of that. We're now laying an undersea cable on the western coast of the continent. That hopefully will help to, you know, address some of the connectivity issues we have on the Google side. On the YouTube side, it's continuing to invest in terms of our relationship with creators and artists, making sure that they know how to really leverage the power of this platform. We launched a $100 million sort of Black Voices Fund, and being this is the blackest continent in the world, we made sure that that money also is now being got to our creators and artists in Africa to help them to create better content on YouTube. So it's money for them, to be able to, again, raise the level of the next generation of creators on the platform. So that's what we want to do. That's our appetite to do that. You know, what's great about YouTube is it's even more of a democratized sort of avenue for you than even, you know, where I was before.
Yeah.
I'm excited about what we did. But now, as a creator, you get to create what you want, right? So long as it's not, you know, going to violate our policies of hate and harassment and all the things that are bad in the world, you put your content on YouTube, and if it reaches the people that you want to reach, you collect your money, right? So there's no gatekeeper between you saying this content is not good enough or this and that. You get to create with your own voice what you want to do. So for me, that's what excites me about YouTube, is the opportunity that we have. I think that, as I said earlier in an earlier panel, I think that the more young Africans come online, right, and part of that is going to be the infrastructural challenges, you know, data costs, etc. The more there's that explosion of sort of users in Africa, the more African content and creators are also, you know, African content creators and artists are also going to realize money from this continent. But again, what's special about YouTube, if you're a creator, is that that content that you create travels to the extent that people in the U.S. or wherever consuming that content, And you can still have an opportunity to receive revenue from those markets based on advertising that's placed against your content on those markets. So you're not just relegated to the advertising that you're going to make in Anambra State or Nigeria or Africa. You cannot, you know, there's a global opportunity for you to actually be able to monetize globally.
I think we really like the concept of earning globally, especially those of you who might be Nigerian and are trying to support your Naira with dollars.
You're a rich man.
No, so let's speak to that. I'm going to open the questions to the floor shortly. But in terms of earning, right, earning as a content producer, currently it's not, at least in Nigeria, it's a bit difficult to be on the earning platform. You either have to have an overseas payment platform. It hasn't completely been integrated into our financial system locally. And then you have aggregators. What's the future of earning for content producers on YouTube?
I think, look, content producers are earning money now. Honestly, they're getting their money. I think that the future is going to be, there's going to be more integration in terms of payments, right? Which I think, you know, all of this is a process, right? And I'm not saying it because if we can control the entire ecosystem ourselves, I'm sure it would make it a lot easier. But that's not that's not the business we have, right? So we have to make sure that we're partnering. I just think that the world is excited about the content that we're creating. The world is excited about the music that we're making. You're seeing that, Ike. You are one of the people. They don't know how old you are, even though you look young. You're one of the people that's been championing this industry from day one, right? So you are the face, you're an embodiment of success in the space, but you've also been a promoter.
Thank you.
It's coming. For those of us that were part of opening the door, it doesn't matter if any of us are remembered. What matters is the future generation now reaping the benefits of that, and more future generations are going to. And I think technology is the opportunity that we have to be able to sort of solve some of the structural challenges. When we were speaking earlier about the music space, African music has always been great. But the biggest challenge has always been about how do you get the content distributed to the people that want to get it. Now with DSPs like us, you know, who really do a good job of it, YouTube, people are able to at least get this content. Yeah. Now, to your question, you want more people online to be able to now access this content. You want more people being able to be in that space. While more people are getting on mobile phones in the continent and coming online, there's still a disparity between the people that can really afford to watch a lot of content and those that can't, right? So I think those are some of the things that are gonna start to get better. I don't know if you remember, Ike, when it was so expensive to get a SIM card.
Yeah, 64,000 Naira.
64,000 Naira. Yeah. It was painful. And that was when Naira had real value.
Yeah.
Now it's free.
Yeah.
Right? And now voice became a thing of the past, right? So I think, again, that will evolve. And as that evolves, it's going to even create more revenue opportunities and more power and more opportunities for our creators and artists to really be able to take it to the next level. I mean, what you're seeing now is incredible, right? You're seeing Burna Boy, 20,000 people in Paris, Wizkid doing an entire American tour. And it's just not them, a whole bunch of other artists touring the world. And again, that is the evolution of the space that you're seeing. And I think as a promotional platform, a lot of people are also able to sample and experience these artists, you know, not just because of YouTube, but because we're part of it.
All right, last question before I open it up to the crowd. You've been part of disrupting media. YouTube has been crucial to just, you know, disrupting traditional terrestrial TV, even satellite TV, by bringing content directly to people. Look into your future crystal ball. What do you see media being dominated by in another 15 years?
You have to share with me when you get this money. No, listen, I don't have a crystal ball, but I do think that what you're going to see is that users and consumers are going to want more and more what they want, you know, how they want it and when they want it, right? And I think that's already the case in a lot of markets where, you know, it's all you can eat data, et cetera. I think that would even become more the case on the continent. You know, I don't know how many times I still watch television, but I don't know how many times I'm watching television live unless it's Arsenal playing. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Beyond that, everything is on demand for me, right? And because of my schedule and how I work. And you know, it's even more pronounced for my kids. right? They see it, but they want to, it's on demand. So I think that the future still leans to content being on demand. So as a content creator, it's going to be important to figure out which platforms you want to leverage to get your content out. I think that's sort of, for me, where it's always going to be. It's going to be in that world where everything that we've seen today, all the innovation, all the disruption that we've seen today is going that step further in being able to address the consumer's taste and appetite and needs. So how do you figure that out, right? I mean, if you told me that taking pictures, you know, is going to be what people are going to want to see, if Kodak knew that, they probably would have evolved to that and not died, right? But it's about saying, where is consumer behavior going and what should you get in front of it?
Yeah, okay. Guys, I'm going to open up the floor. Take advantage of this moment. Some of the people we have at these fireside chats, you'll only see in newspaper publications and on TV and may not get to run into regularly. So don't be shy. Ask your questions, especially the ones that pertain to your business. It will really help you to hear from this end of the table. Do we have any questions from the floor? We have a gentleman at the back. If we could get a microphone to him. Well, you know what, sir? Just scream out your question. I'll repeat it for you. Say that again, sir.
Sorry?
Go ahead, but a bit louder, please. Yeah.
In Africa.
Yeah.
But an argument could be made that MTV lost the opportunity to lead this digitization. To lead this digitization effort, and it became focused on sort of diversifying its content offerings or reality TV and stuff. I just want to know if you were, what would you have done, you know, with your experience in MTV to sort of lead that?
You want me to talk about where I was? I want to talk about where I am.
I like that.
You know what I mean? No, listen, I think that people need to understand that MTV still today is incredibly powerful and valuable in this space. I think MTV is digital. Viacom CBS has acquired a whole bunch of assets that still work for them in the digital space. I think that it's time and situation. At the end of the day, there are businesses that are formed that cater to particular pieces of work. So there's tech businesses that was about scale. Traditional media businesses, you know, you can argue maybe some of them didn't evolve quickly enough at the time. Businesses, right? On this continent, you know, there's still incredibly steep growth in terms of you bringing users online. So when you are running a business, right, you have to make sure you are paying the hundreds of people you have and all those things, and sometimes you're going to lean initially to where the real revenue is coming while you're developing the other spaces. So I wouldn't want to go back and be critical of anything that could have been different. I think, again, it's about there's platforms, and that's what they do. Their content, you know, they're not a tech platform, to say the least.
I think it's important to, sorry, sir, we'll get to your question in just a second. I think it's important as well, you know, it's big corporates have directions that they take and sometimes they stick to it, but then it's also good to, it's coming across a little bit muffled for us here.
Hello, my name is Idris.
Much better.
Host of the Smasher Show on Horizon Radio 104.3 FM, and my question is that can you give us strategies to monetize music content on YouTube?
Like, huh, if I give you that one, you won't come to tomorrow's session.
Just tell us a little. Maybe three points on how musicians can make revenue from YouTube. Good one.
Look, we always talk about what's amazing about YouTube is, like, you know, we have, you know, what our global head of music, who is this genius, Leo Cohen, says, is that we have this twin engine that's really powerful. There's a subscription aspect of it where, of course, you can make money from subscription revenue on the continent, and obviously the advertising part of it. I think that the real key is to be able to A, out on YouTube. And you're like, why? Okay? I think, first of all, it's important to get on the platform. I think it's also important to make sure that you are putting up content that's consistent. It doesn't have to be a music video. It could be stuff that you're doing behind the scenes. What's really important about platform? platforms like ours is that your personality matters. Yeah. Can you bring your personality? That's kind of what people want to see. People, of course, want to see your music, but they can catch it any day of the, any time of the day. Can they see you and your personality doing other things? That's important on the platform. So those are some of the tips I'll give you for today, with the rest to come tomorrow when you come to tomorrow's session.
Thank you. Any other questions? Go ahead, ma'am.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Nondobeko Mkhize, from here in Durban. You guys spoke about having an authentic mission to create content, but then you said the most important thing is to have the right team to help bring out the juices. So my question is, how does one go about getting that team? Because sometimes they charge a hell of a lot, an arm and a leg, for you to be able to actually tell your story and for them to take it and, you know, create it and bring it into content that can be sold out there. Maybe I'll just make an example, because I've been given a platform, so maybe I'll never get it again, so I might as well, you know. I remember IK with the Nigerian Idols. I was very inspired when you guys gave the contestants the theme of singing the African legends. And that guy that won, when he sang that Lion King's song, I can't remember what it is. Yeah, but one, I was really inspired. First to know that he's a Nigerian, and yet he has taken a South African artist idea and put it with such passion on an African stage. Yeah. I was very inspired. So with us, I'll speak for those as well who cannot make it here. There's a whole lot of content out there, but then it's difficult. You just sit at home and get addicted to reality shows because you see yourself in them, but then it's like, okay, there's nothing I can do. I'll just sit in my corner, and that's it. So it's my question is, how does one go about finding the teams that will listen to you, listen to your stories, and then take it from there? Thank you.
Okay, that's a big question. So hey, how'd you get that team?
How'd I get that team? First of all, you got to get people that not just want to listen to you. That's a problem. You got to get people that want to work with you, that are going to challenge your thinking, that are going to bring new ideas to the table. Because if you're just there to be listened to, then that means there's only one idea that is going to drive the place, right? So I think you gotta be able to find people that are...
That's good. That's good. That's good right there.
You gotta be able to find people that, you know, I always say this, it sounds crazy, but people don't get it. You gotta get people that are better than you at what they do. Right? Like, they gotta be really better than you so you can learn from them. Because maybe the value that you have is to ask them the one or two questions that inspires them to even go deeper. And that's oftentimes people don't do that because they want to be the smartest person in the room. I think it's the other way around. And I think when you do that to begin with, and you give people some level of ownership, you really make them understand that their importance and their impact is so critical to the success. People work harder when they believe. And people come up with more ideas, and they believe that A, they can fail, right, and not be screamed on or be yelled at or be reprimanded too harshly. But there's an environment where you can try things and push the envelope, knowing that you're doing it for good reasons. So I'm not saying fail to the hell of it because you're unprepared. But if you're prepared and you put in the work, you do the research, and you try an idea, it doesn't work, you can learn so much from it. And for me, that's really, really crucial. And I think, you know, in a lot of ways, that's the culture that I've always wanted to build, which is, you know, that's really sort of a team of people that are accountable, that I have a plan, that are collaborative, that find innovation. And that's been sort of, I have values that I've rolled throughout my life with. And that's also what helps me filter out the people that, you know, I want to work with, especially if I'm the one that's employing them. I look for those people that, A, I can learn from, and B, they believe in the mission. And you can tell. Sometimes you're not going to get that. Sometimes it doesn't work out. And you also got to be willing to realize not every person is going to be magical, but at least you're not playing it safe by trying to find people that will listen to you.
I like that. And that speaks to a conversation I had with Vincent Berry yesterday, where he was teaching me about the structure, you know, people who make it into the establishment, who make it into the big corporates, and how they can lift you and bring you into that space. I think what she was also asking was, how do I get from being the local player, being that person who just has the talent, to the person who has the structure behind them? And what I will say to that is, he spoke a lot about research at the start of this conversation and how he did a lot of research. I think if you do quite a bit of research on your own, you'll find that also there are platforms like this everywhere. Apart from this, when he was with MTV, he used to have a platform called MTV Base Meets, where they would bring industry professionals in to talk to you about what they were expecting and help you structure businesses and all of that to help you elevate your structure. And I think there are a few of those going on around the continent, and some of them are just online. They don't really have a cost to them. So research will help to help you build your team as well.
YouTube it.
Hi, Alex. Sorry, I've got a completely different question. My name is Ilana Brendane, and I'm from the visual arts, more museum kind of director. That's my love. But the past week, I've been watching the world and these jumps that we've seen, you know, the metaverse, the launch of the metaverse, you know, Zuckerberg out there. I watched the keynote of Jensen Huang, who spoke, you know, of these new big CPUs and, you know, how the supercomputers are jumping. And it feels like, just as I get there, I feel like, are we keeping up with all of these things that are happening so fast around the world? And how does it relate back to us here, who's just grabbing onto all these platforms?
Look, that's a big question. I also try to keep it real. I also kind of try to keep it real simply smart for myself, in focusing on the core of what I do, right? So you say that you're in the visual arts.
Yeah.
The question is, for you, forget whatever universe people are trying to create or whatever, right? Are you leveraging sort of all the platforms you can to tell your story, right? So for instance, one of the things that we found during the COVID was that people were home. People leaned into more being able to engage with content that they want on demand. People were exploring all kinds of content. You know, I would say, for instance, in our Russia business, they put the Bolshoi Theater, which is one of the more successful sort of ballet theater. They put a lot of their content on YouTube, right? They opened a whole new world for who can access their content and who leaned into that content, because it's really quality stuff that you would ordinarily have had to go and pay for to get into that performance. So I still think that, leaving all that stuff aside, is A, what do I do, right? And how do I take what I do and make sure that I'm being able to share it with the world, right? And I'm, you know, and for me, that's how I kind of keep up with what becomes important for me to listen to. Because you're right, there's a whole bunch of evolution in the space. It can seem a little daunting to look at it that way. I would say just kind of keep it simply smart to what do I do and how do I make sure that I'm leveraging all the platforms possible to maximize the impact that I can have. I hope that's helpful.
Let me ask you a question to further what you just said to her. So she has content, she puts it, whatever visual content or musical content, video content, she puts it on her channel on YouTube. Right, she has maybe 2,000 followers on Twitter and Instagram, and she's trying to use all of that to leverage and push the content she has on YouTube. What other means are there available to her to really tell the world, look, go check my channel out, because she's trying to monetize and earn, especially now that people are out of the job because of COVID. What other channels are available to her to push the word about what she's doing as an individual on YouTube?
First of all, she has to start with her YouTube channel. Does she have the right thumbnails for how her YouTube channel looks? Does she have, you know, trailers to be able to sort of describe what she has? Does she have a personality? The plethora of information is really about being able to, as you said, as we talked about earlier, being able to spend the time trying to understand the space. There is no magic button. It's also about leveraging all of the platforms that she's on to promote each other, right? And also looking at people that you partner with to co-create together. There's also creators that are doing incredibly well that you may want to partner with, or those that may also be like you, up and coming, that if all of a sudden you're exposing your content to, you know, audiences that may not know you guys, all of a sudden you have the opportunity to kind of gain more audience that will then enable the content to also, you know, rise up in terms of, you know, recommendations. and then put you in a situation where you can actually monetize better. So there is a plethora of ways in which to think about how to sort of ratchet up your monetization, but the key is still boils down to, do you know what you want to put up there? Do you understand what people want to see? Is it authentically what you can get behind? Are you going to have regularity in putting up that content, right? Because again, you put out one piece of content every month and you're waiting for to make money, you're fooling yourself.
We have another question.
All right. Thank you very much. My name is Hastings Golos from Malawi. Alex, what you have done is amazing. I'm an upcoming filmmaker. I've just recently produced my first feature film that is representing my country in Oscars.
Well done. Well done.
Thank you. I like the point that you said, gone are the days when Africa was struggling to produce content. I think now the issue is distribution. That has given me hope. Because back in my country, if you Google Malawi, it's one of the poorest countries in the world. But there's creative minds there. But now what's happening now is we are struggling to take our creative outside our borders. We are pushing, maybe we can penetrate into Zambia, Zimbabwe, or at least the SADC region. This conference has opened my eyes because now I've seen that there's hope. Now, I want you to be honest with me. Have you managed what, have you done what you've done because you were exposed, like, outside Africa? Then you came here and said, okay, there's hope. Let me take content outside Africa. What would you tell a person like me who is very creative, who is from the very poorest country, but do you think there's hope? And do you have a formula? How best can I take the creative thing outside my country? I hope my question is not complicated. Thank you.
No, your question is not complicated, just very rich. It's a rich question. So we have to now figure out how to answer this very rich question. First of all, the single biggest thing that we have to realize is that creativity is incredibly powerful and there's no limitation to it.
That's right.
And there is, I don't even call it hope, because hope sometimes feels so like, there's hope, there's opportunity, right?
Like that.
And I think it's about being able to embrace all the opportunities that are available. It's never gonna come overnight. I could tell based on, you know, listening to you that you are definitely putting in the work and you're pushing. It is about being able, you know, you're not going to be able to jump from unknown tomorrow to being a superstar. And sometimes people forget, there's never that journey. There's very, very rare does that happen. But it is about what you're saying. Hey, how, you know, what opportunities do I have in Malawi to start earning something? What opportunities do I have in the neighboring markets to start earning something? But more importantly, what opportunities do I have to take this content that I have and put it on platforms where people can discover it? And once I put on those platforms, how do I make sure I research all the things I must do to maximize the opportunity for this content to be successful on those platforms? And again, I say this with no fear of contradiction in any way, shape, or form, is Nollywood content is thriving on YouTube, right?
Sure.
African content, non-Nollywood, is thriving on YouTube. Our content is traveling globally. That in itself should enable you to see the opportunity that is not about you being from Malawi anymore. It's about, can you create hot-ish that people want to see? And if you can do that, there is no such thing as hope. There's an opportunity that you need to embrace and keep on staying focused on that mission. That's there, for me, honestly, there is, I can't sit here and say that where the formula is, no. There's incredibly successful business people on this continent that have never left Africa.
That's right.
And they know way more than people that left and came back, because they grew up every single day figuring out solutions for the challenges. So there is no formula. You don't have to go to Harvard. You have to go to the U.S. and come back with a fake accent. Just your work.
Oh, that's nice. That's nice. Oh, before he speaks, ladies and gentlemen, this is another individual that you will get to hear from. If you come back on the 20th, I'll have a chance to have him also in the hot seat in a fireside
conversation. He's Vincent Berry. Many of the artists who've been in the live theater have had a chance to learn from him how to build structure, how to increase their knowledge of IP. Basically, he puts you on and gets you in the room. Mr. Vincent Berry, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you so much. I'm happy to be here. Alex, so inspired by you, bro. We're going to have plenty more conversations. IK, what an incredible job, bro.
My bad.
I live in Los Angeles, and one of the things that is really most disruptive about YouTube from the perspective of content creators in Los Angeles was YouTube space. And because of COVID, quite naturally, we knew that that would change infrastructure quite a bit. But in February, you guys announced that you closed not just L.A., New York, London, Paris, Rio de Janeiro. You've closed these YouTube spaces permanently. I would love to hear from you about, obviously, I understand why on the level of COVID, but permanently is a little, you know, that speaks heavily to one of the reasons why I thought it was so disruptive and why so many creators was so drawn to YouTube because of the spaces you created, 48,000 square feet, all the cameras in the world, sound stages, editors, editing bays, you know, used for
I know he's going to ask the hard questions.
I want to know because in my mind, I think it presents an incredible opportunity for us across the continent to possibly create those spaces for people to create that
Look,
content.
Absolutely. I think for us, it was really trying to figure out how do we touch more people. And what we want to do is rather than have a physical static place to take the show on the road. So that's really the model. We're going to be able to touch more creators in our sort of new model of kind of going out and doing events versus having a static place where people must come to. I think we'll still enable people to be able to create. What you've said is perfect. You now live in a world where we know creation can be done virtually. And it's about being able to lean into it. And you know that you can learn virtually as well and be able to create that camaraderie. Of course, nothing beats being able to come together in physical spaces, but it was an evolution for us that we thought, wow, what an opportunity to now be able to actually even touch more people by having a much even more scaled approach to being able to take our brand on the road, right? To be able to do more, I would call it more pop-up opportunities than it is going to be having a static space. But again, as you said, maybe there is an opportunity to find some barrier to be able to, you know, create something. That houses a whole bunch of people and be that space. So again, I think those are options that exist, but I for one, I'm excited about what we pivoted to because I think is the right approach for us to reach more people. You know, what we're trying to do on this continent, you know, working with Zeph and everyone else at Google that we have on the ground is definitely to be able to touch as many people in terms of, there's a lot of education, training, workshop that needs to go into it. And you really want to make sure that a lot of people get access to it. So that's sort of our focus. You know, one of the things that, I'll be honest, coming to Google and YouTube that excites me is just how much more we can scale this opportunity and create more opportunities for Africans. It's just, you know, I'm counting the millions in now. It's just so much opportunity that of what we can deliver. So I hope that's a good enough answer to your question. All right, cool. Thanks, man.
I still have a, okay, well, I'll take your question quickly.
Sorry, thank you. Hi, my name is Michelle Chubunga, and I'm running a fintech blockchain and investment company based out of London. The reason I'm kind of here for us is that we're really interested in looking at investment opportunities in Africa, particularly, you know, within the sort of media, fashion space. And what we are seeing at the moment is obviously that combination of tech and entertainment. So from your experiences, obviously, you've had a pretty global reach. So if you were advising investors like ourselves in terms of what region we should focus on, what would that region be?
You want that for free.
We can talk.
You see how she's treating? She wants this for free.
Do it. I can help you with NFTs as payment, but let's, you know. So wondering what your thoughts are around that.
No, look, I think now, you know, just to sort of ask more broadly, I think now more than ever is the time for you guys to do invest. I think that the opportunities are endless in what this continent needs. Again, I don't look at, you know, you can focus on the infrastructural challenges, but you can solve for that. You know, tech can solve for that. So I think now more than ever is the time for you guys to invest. I think that's a wonderful opportunity. I think that you guys should really pursue it. We can obviously speak a little bit more offline in terms of what I think our learnings are. But for me, and then again, just trying to be authentic to this,
I'm always a believer in supporting and giving as much information to anyone that wants to help develop any market, but more importantly, Africa, because I know, you know, nothing I've done has been alone, and a lot of people have helped, again, provide insight, information, support, partnerships to help us get here. So let's definitely chat. And it will be free, don't worry.
All right, I think we've run out of time, but he is still going to be part of Canex. So if you have other questions that you want to ask, I suggest that you come back tomorrow. You're speaking tomorrow, I believe?
Yes, tomorrow.
And his panel is going
to be... Monetizing social and digital media. So for all of us that want money, tomorrow.
Tomorrow is the time.
And it's not just going to be me. It's going to be a panel of experts. I'll provide you that information. So please show up. Really excited. Sorry.
You're great. Ladies and gentlemen, I really think you should take advantage of everything happening here at Canex, whether it's listening to Mr. Okosi, listening to Mr. Berry. Like I said, you don't get these opportunities every day to sit in the room with people who've either fought their way to where they are today or who daily are looking for people like you to elevate and to partner with. So take advantage of it. Come for as many of the sessions as you can. Listen to all the fireside chats. Visit the various stalls. Canex is about you, the creatives. Yeah, but we also want to say a very big thank you to you, Mr. Alex Okosi, for taking our time to be here today and for being very open with all the questions. Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, Alex Okosi, thank you so much.
My man, you're great at this. Man. You are really good at this.
Ladies and gentlemen, that does bring us to the end of our day. Please make sure you join us tomorrow. Of course, the boss, Alex, will be here tomorrow, and he'll be talking about how you can monetize your social media platforms. Trust me, it's how I've made a living for a really long time. You want to be there. For those of you who have been with us this morning, all the way to today, thank you so much. It's been an absolutely fantastic day. We look forward to seeing you tomorrow, and we look forward to seeing you right after this at the cocktail party. It is brought to you by Afrexim Bank. Hope you enjoyed your first day. Tomorrow, I promise, is going to be even better. See you tomorrow.